But France, France is going to win.
No,
no? You didn't say that. Sure. Okay. So let me start with. So this is the title. You will understand the title, I hope, during the seminar. Let me start with this guy, Stendhal. So Stendhal was a very famous French writer of the 19th century. He wrote magnificent novels. It's probably one of the best writers, if not the best. Writer at that French writer at that time, Stendhal. And so he wrote La Chartreuse de Parme, Le Rouge et le Noir. And when he was young, he was very good in mathematics. And he was planning, in fact, to enter École Polytechnique in Paris. I don't know if you have heard about École Polytechnique. It's a famous grande école in France. It has been founded during the French Revolution. So Stendhal was so good that he was planning to enter École Polytechnique. He came to Paris to prepare for the exam, the entrance exam. But finally, he changed his mind in 1800 to follow Napoleon's campaign in Italy. He wrote an autobiographical book, which is called Vie de Henri Brulard, and in this book, he writes about his passion for mathematics. So let us read together what Stendhal was saying about mathematics. I loved and I still love mathematics for its own sake, as not tolerating hypocrisy and vagueness, my two utmost abhorrent beasts. Then he says, my passionate cohabitation with mathematics has left me with a crazy love for the right definitions, without which there are only approximations. Then, what was my dismay when I realized nobody could explain to me how it happens that minus multiplied by minus gives plus. Minus times minus equals plus. This is one of the fundamental basis of the science we call algebra. Then he add, worse than not being explained this difficulty, which no doubt is explainable because it leads to the truth. Minus times minus is equal plus, right? It's true. I was given explanations that were obviously unclear to those who presented them to me. So these people were saying to Stendhal, his professors, etc., his teachers, but this is how it goes. Everybody agrees on this explanation. Minus times minus is plus, right? Euler and Lagrange, who apparently were as valuable as you are, did admit it. Okay? So this is the argument d'autorité. How do you say that in English? Or in Portuguese? Argument. Okay. So he concludes, I was reduced to what I still confide to myself today. It must be that minus times minus gives plus be true, since obviously, by repeatedly applying this rule in calculus, one reaches true and indubitable results. Okay, so this is Stendhal problem. Why minus times minus is equal to plus? We indeed all agree. If we take the simple example of three bags, each containing four marbles altogether, we all agree that if I take this example of three bags, each containing four marbles, altogether these three bags will contain 12 marbles, right? 3 times 4 is equal to 12. This is easy to explain. This is easy to understand. It's a simple counting, right? You can do it. It's not difficult. But how to explain that minus 3 times minus 4 is equal to 12? If I follow this reasoning, we claim that minus 3 bags, each containing minus 4 marbles, contain 12 marbles. Right? Okay. okay, let's try to be in the Stendhal point of view, right? You are a child, you are 10 years old, you're at school, and I'm telling you that minus three bags containing minus four marbles contain 12 marbles. It's absurd. So say like this, it sounds absurd, meaningless. Of course, everybody knows this basic algebraic rule. Still, if we were today to make a poll in this room, I am afraid that very few of you would be able to give a simple, convincing, and clear explanation that Stendhal was asking for. Why minus times minus is equal to plus? This is extraordinary, if you think to it. A very basic and fundamental rule of algebra is not really explained, and it is not understood. We all agree, we all know that minus times minus is equal to plus, but why is it so? How can I explain this to a child which is in school, 10 years old? How can I explain him that minus 3 times minus 4 is equal to 12? This is Stendhal's question, right? So it is given as an obvious fact. It is as it is because it should be so. Right? It's like an axiom, a postulate, an axiom. And Stendhal is not happy with that, of course. Why is it so? Could it be that this lack of explanation is related to our understanding of what mathematics and physics are about? To our assumptions about what they really mean, mathematics and physics. Okay, so let us come to a long time ago, this famous sentence, which is written in Italian. Il libro della natura è scritto in lingua matematica. This is Galileo Galilei. As you all know, of course, Galileo was an Italian, an Italian astronomer, physicist, engineer, etc., etc. He played a major role in the scientific revolution of the 17th century. He is considered as the father of observational astronomy, of modern physics, of the scientific method, and even as the father of science. So I'm going to translate this now and give you the full sentence of Galileo. Philosophy, nature, is written in that great book, whichever is before our eyes, I mean the universe, but we cannot understand it if we do not first learn the language and grasp the symbols in which it is written. The book is written in mathematical language, and the symbols are triangles, circles, and other geometrical figures, without whose help it is impossible to comprehend a single word of it, without which one wanders in vain through a dark labyrinth. Okay? This is Galileo Galilei, a long time ago. So let us move a little bit closer in time. There is this famous sentence, this famous title of an article, The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in the Natural Science by Wigner. So Wigner was an Hungarian American theoretical physicist and mathematician. He got the Nobel Prize in 1963 for his contribution to the theory of the atomic nucleus and elementary particles, and in particular for the discovery and application of fundamental symmetry principle. So let me give you a part of this article. The title is this: The Miracle of the Appropriateness of the Language of Mathematics for the Formulation of the Laws of Physics is a Wonderful Gift which we never understand nor deserve. It's very strange to write this, right? It's a wonderful gift that is given to us, the mathematics, which we never understand nor deserve. We should be grateful for it and hope that it will remain valid in future research and that it will extend, for better or for worse, to our pleasure and even through perhaps also to our bafflement, to wide branches of learning. So this is the reference of this article. It's a very interesting article in Communication in Pure and Applied Mathematics. Okay, let's now move to even closer in time, to this extraordinary sentence. Mathematics is a part of physics. Physics is an experimental science, a part of natural science. Mathematics is the part of physics where experiments are cheap. It's completely opposite to what Wigner says, right? Wigner is totally baffled by the fact that mathematics could be applied to the real world. And Arnold, the guy who wrote this, is Arnold. Arnold is a Russian mathematician, best known for the Kolmogorov-Arnold-Moser theorem, important contribution in dynamical system, catastrophe theory, etc., including the IDE classification problem, after solving Ebert's 13th problem in 1957 at the age of 19. He was very young when he did that. And this paper by Arnold, where this sentence is contained in this paper, is an address at a round table on the teaching of mathematics in Palais de la Découverte in Paris in 1997. So you see, you have completely two different points of view which are totally opposite, right? What Arnold is telling us is that mathematics is physics. It's even a part of physics. It's the part of physics where you don't need any money because there is no experiment. It's very cheap. Okay, so let's come back to Wigner, the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in the natural science. Wigner sees mathematics as an abstraction produced by the human brain. The fact that it is appropriate to describe a real world is considered a miracle, right? And Arnold, on the contrary, seems to tell us that if mathematics works so well to describe natural phenomena, it is because they are part of physics, part of nature. My point of view is to side with Arnold, right? It is indeed impossible that anything constructed, devised by humans, not be part of nature. So it is not a surprise that mathematics describe the real world, because mathematics is the real world. Okay? So it's, of course, if you look at this statement by Arnold, it's a bit provocative, right? It's an extreme statement. It is really, as Arnold was, he was a very tough and provocative guy. But, of course, it remains true that many mathematical objects elude an immediate or natural appropriation. Right? So if you think to what means a very big number, it's very difficult for us to understand what is a very, really very big number, right? Even without approaching the notion of infinity. But still, I think Arnold is right, basically, even if it is a bit provocative, right? So I am also taking Arnold's point of view side because I see his point of view as the only valid starting point to teach mathematics so as to make them understandable, right? You have to understand mathematics as something which is concrete, real, not something which is an abstraction which by chance applies to the reality. Indeed, can we answer Stendhal's query and explain him that minus multiplied by minus equal plus? So if I follow Arnold, I would be able to do that with a simple, concrete, experimental reasoning, like by drawing on a piece of paper. By a natural reasoning, without relying on abstract statements, postulates, or actions. So, even before trying to explain minus times minus equal plus, we should begin with explain to Stendhal what is minus, what is a negative number. I come back to my question, to your question. So again, you have a child in front of you. He's 10 years old, right? You are going to tell him count marbles in a bag. He knows how to do that, right? So one can remove one marble from a bag containing four marbles. Three marbles will be left, right? Four from which one is removed is three. Four minus one equals three. It's true. You can check it, right? It's not difficult. You can even remove four marbles from a bag containing four marbles. There will be no any marble left. Four from which four is removed equals nothing. Okay, so you call this zero. This nothing, you call it zero. Four minus four equals zero. Okay, we agree. But five marbles cannot be removed from a bag containing four marbles. it is impossible. This experience forbids it, right? If you have 4 marbles in a bag, you cannot remove 5 marbles. You cannot. It's impossible. It's forbidden by the experiment. Still, one writes 4 minus 5 equals minus 1. How can we explain the negative number minus 1? So, there are several arguments. One argument is the steps in a staircase. So, you are in a house, right? You are in Stendhal's house, in his house. You start on the ground floor and you go up to the upper floors and you count the steps. So, there will be a step number 1, step number 2, step number 3. Then you can start on the ground floor and you can go down to the cellar and you can count the steps. Steps number minus 1, step number minus 2. So you start saying, well, this is the negative number, right? But this is a bit artificial. Stendhal will surely ask, why not counting the steps starting from the bottom of the staircase, right in the cellar, right, at the bottom? There is no need to do that, to say, I start from the first floor and count minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. I can start from the bottom in the cellar and it will be still always positive, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? You could also argue with the money that Stendhal owes to the bank. He borrowed 10,000 reals from the bank. He owes this amount to the bank. His account is negative, minus 10,000 reals. Still, it's a bit artificial. Stendhal received 10,000 reals from the bank. It must return 10,000 reals. These numbers are no doubt positive, right? So, what is a negative number? What means the minus sign? And why minus multiplied by minus gives plus again? Why minus 3 times minus 4 equals 12? So, for sure, 3 times 4 equals 12. 3 bags of 4 marbles each contain altogether 12 marbles. This is true. It makes sense. It can be checked experimentally. Again, you count the marbles in the 3 bags, right? I have 3 bags containing each 4 marbles, which is 4 plus 4 plus 4, which is 12. And you can also check that 4 bags with 3 marbles each also contain altogether 12 marbles. Again, you count 4 times 3 is 3 plus 3 plus 3 plus 3, which is 12, right? So 3 times 4 equals 4 times 3 equals 12. The multiplication is commutative. It is an experimental fact. It is a natural fact, if I follow Arnold's point of view. It is true. It can be checked by counting. It's an experiment. Clearly, Stendhal understands easily the positive numbers. He can learn how to add, subtract, multiply, divide them. It is from the positive numbers that he is going to construct the negative ones. So, a warning. You are going to see nothing new. All I am going to say is obvious. Or rather, it should be obvious. Right? I'm not sure it is obvious, but it should be obvious. So, he draws on a piece of paper a line, and on this line, Stendhal, right? He arranges the integers by increasing order. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. The integers are now points on this line. Okay, so Stendhal do this drawing on a piece of paper. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. On the same piece of paper, he then starts turning these points around 0. Again, this is a quite trivial experience, analogous to what every child does when he runs around the tree in the school playground. He can understand that easily, right? He's here, he takes 2, and it starts going with 2 around 0. Okay, so he does that. He can go either clockwise or anticlockwise. After half a turn, he has reached this side of this line. Before he had 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now he has this point here, this new point. He has reached this new point after either half a turn or minus half a turn. We tell him that the points he has reached after half a turn are the negative numbers. So we understand the negative numbers as starting from the positive number, and doing half a turn and going on this, what we call now the negative numbers, right? Negative axis. So we denote them minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4. Okay, so now what he has the positive numbers and the negative numbers that he has obtained in this way, by this half turn. So Stendhal has just understood that minus 1 is 1 followed by half a turn. Minus 2 is 2 followed by a half turn, etc., etc. And he can also check easily on this drawing that before, of course, 0 was smaller than 1, smaller than 2, smaller than 3, but now minus 4 is smaller than minus 3, smaller than minus 2, etc. He sees that on this line, on this picture, on this drawing, easily. But how to multiply minus 3 by minus 4? Okay, so minus 3 times minus 4 is 3 followed by half a turn, multiplied by 4 followed by half a turn. Okay, so it's 3 times 4 followed by half a turn, followed by half a turn. It's 12 followed by a full turn. Okay, so in that case, I'm considering negative numbers which are obtained like this. Of course, you can obtain also negative numbers like that. So there are several possibilities in this multiplication. I am just taking one case. You can check the other case. You will always reach the same conclusion. What is 12 followed by a turn, a full turn? What is 12 followed by a full turn? It's obvious, right? I come back to where I started from. So 12 followed by a full turn is 12. So minus 3 times minus 4 equals 12. And you can also check in the same way that minus 4 times minus 3, the commutativity is also plus 12. Right? So his multiplication rule is indeed commutative. Good. So why is it nice to introduce negative numbers and understand minus times minus equal plus in this way? Because Stendhal is a clever guy. Right? And now he can proceed further. He realized that it is possible to reach any point M in the plane in the same way, simply by starting from a point on the horizontal line at a distance OM from zero and turning around again zero by an angle theta M. Right? So again, I do the same thing as for the negative number. I start here at a distance OM and turn of an angle theta M. And now I am in the plane. He can reach any point in the plane exactly in the same way as he was able to attain the negative number. He also realized that he knows in full generality how to multiply in the plane two such points, M and M prime. Right, so I have two points now, M, with an angle theta M, a distance OM, M prime with an angle theta m prime and a distance om prime. He knows how to multiply them, m times m prime, exactly as for the multiplication of negative number. It's om followed by a rotation of an angle theta m, multiplied by om prime, followed by a rotation angle theta m prime. So this is om times om prime, followed by a rotation angle theta m plus theta m prime. He can do the same thing if he wants to multiply m prime by m. He verifies, obviously, that m times m prime equals m prime times m. Indeed, om times om prime is om prime times om here. And theta m plus theta m prime is theta m prime plus theta m. So his multiplication rule is indeed commutative. So while trying to understand what the negative numbers are and how to multiply them, the childhood dream of Stendhal, he has also found a way to reach all the points in the plane, and even better, the commutative multiplication rule, which allows for the multiplication of these points between themselves. Right? So again, we start from the equation y minus times minus equal plus. And we reach this conclusion that we know how to multiply any points m and m prime in the plane, exactly in the same way as we understand minus times minus equal plus. All right? Not only that, doing so, he has also got for free the so-called complex or imaginary or impossible numbers. So complex, imaginary, you know the names, of course. But there is also the name impossible. The complex or imaginary number were also called impossible numbers when they were discovered. So let us go back again in the past. Girolamo Cardano, it's again an Italian mathematician, physician, biologist, physicist, etc., etc., well known for his achievements in algebra, and he was the first to use negative numbers in Europe and acknowledge the existence of imaginary numbers, which were to become the complex number in the 19th century. So the real inventor of the negative number and the complex number is this Italian mathematician called Girolamo Cardano. But I will switch to Leonhard Euler, the famous Swiss mathematician, physicist, astronomer, logician, engineer. We made important discoveries in many branches of mathematics like infinitesimal calculus, graph theory, topology, analytic number theory. He has also introduced much of the modern mathematical terminology, so impossible, imaginary, this is introduced by Euler, this terminology, notations also, particularly for mathematical analysis, such as the notion of a mathematical function. This is Euler. So Euler wrote a very interesting book, which is called Elements of Algebra, and in particular in the chapter 13, about impossible or imaginary quantities which arise from the same source, right? So this is the book. This is the book translated in French. I think it is original translation in the 18th century. So what Euler says? He says that since minus a times minus a equals plus aa. So aa means a times a, right? And plus a times plus a equals plus aa. It is impossible to find a number such that the result of the multiplication of this number by itself is a negative number. In particular, it is impossible to find a number such that the result of the multiplication of this number by itself is minus 1. But one can imagine them, right? So Euler says, but notwithstanding this, these numbers present themselves to the mind. They exist in our imagination, and we still have a sufficient idea of them. For this reason also, nothing prevents us from making use of these imaginary numbers and employing them in calculation. So Euler imagines the number I such that plus I times plus I, which is plus II in this notation, is minus 1. Okay? So let us imagine, like Euler, this number. He calls it imaginary because he has to imagine it, right? So it's impossible, imaginary in fact, by opposition to a real number. For Stendhal, again, Stendhal is a 10 years old boy, all this is barely understandable. But with what he already knows, finding a point in the plane such that the result of the multiplication of this point by itself is minus 1 is trivial. For him, it's trivial, it's obvious. It is 1, I start from 1, and I do a quarter of a turn. So I, for Stendhal, is the point directly on the vertical above O, right? I start from 1 and I do a quarter of turn. And now if I multiply this number, 1, this point, 1 followed by a quarter of a turn, times 1 followed by a quarter of a turn, this is 1 times 1, followed by a quarter of a turn and a quarter of a turn, this is 1 followed by half a turn, this is minus 1, right? So I times I is minus 1. So Stendhal understands that plus multiplied by plus gives minus. He wanted to understand why minus times minus gives plus. But he understands also that plus multiplied by plus gives minus. Right? So this is, of course, it's obvious, right? I start from here, I do a quarter of a turn and another quarter of a turn. I move from 1 to minus 1, so the square of I is minus 1. Okay. For Stendhal, there are no imaginary numbers. There are no impossible numbers. There are no complex numbers. There are no complex plane. There is no complex plane. All this does not exist, right? For Stendhal, I means 1 followed by a quarter of a turn. Minus I means 1 followed by a quarter of a turn and half a turn, which is 1 followed by 3/4 of a turn. There are only points in the plane, the real plane, right, on this piece of paper. It's not a complex plane. It's not an impossible plane. It's the plane, the real plane. There are only points in this plane that he knows how to multiply with this multiplication rule. All the theory of complex number is contained in this multiplication rule, right? Any good, so what I'm saying is that any good mathematics teaching book should always start by introducing the so-called complex numbers as Stendhal discovered them by trying to understand what the minus sign and the algebraic rule minus times minus equal plus really mean. And only after, as a second step, in an algebraist axiomatic reformulation, you can say, if you want, but only after, that by starting from I, defined abstractly as I times I equal minus 1, and from two real numbers A and B, could we introduce the complex number Z, A plus IB, the real part is A, the imaginary part is IB, to arrive at the multiplication rule, Z times Z prime, A plus IB times A prime plus IB prime. Of course, you all know that. In the complex plane, right? So we have an abstract thing, which is called the complex plane. But you have always to keep in mind that the so-called complex plane is nothing else but the usual plane. And this A and B here, which is called the real and the imaginary part, are nothing but the Cartesian coordinate of the point M in the plane. Right? Okay, so what I'm saying is that this, the so-called complex plane with this real axis, imaginary axis, is called the complex plane, is exactly the same thing as this, is exactly the same thing as this. Right? This is totally identical thing. Again, as I told you, all this is obvious, or should be obvious. What matters is the simple way in which things are presented, in which order, with which terminology. Okay? So, what time is it? I went very fast. I am really obsessed by No. So let me, I'm not yet at the end, but let me give you now another illustration of what I'm saying. This one from Arnold himself. The determinants. For example, the determinant of the 4 times 4 matrix. Okay, so this is the rule, right, to compute the determinant of this 4 by 4 matrix. So you have a precise algebraic rule which allows you to say that the determinant of this 4 by 4 matrix is this thing here, right? So again, you can say this is the definition of a determinant. That's all, right? So let us ask the question, but what is the determinant? Stendhal would probably ask, what is a determinant? What does it count? Or what does it measure? Right? The same question, why minus time minus equal plus? Stendhal would ask now, what a determinant is counting? What does it measure? So again, I quote Arnold here. And it's very interesting to read Arnold. So let us read it. Read Arnold together. I shall open a few more such secrets in the interest of poor students. The determinant of a matrix is an oriented volume of a parallelepiped whose edge are its columns. If the students are told this secret, which is carefully hidden in the purified algebraic education, then the whole theory of determinants becomes a clear chapter of the theory of polynomial forms. If determinants are defined otherwise, then any sensible person will forever hate all the determinants, Jacobians, and the implicit function theorem. So again, the way of Arnold to say things in a very blunt and direct way. So what Arnold tells us, that determinant, in the same way I was saying that complex numbers should be introduced in the way we explain to Stendhal why minus times minus equals plus, Arnold tells us that determinant should be really defined like this, like something that you can see visually, you can construct geometrically. It's not an abstraction, it's something real. So what does it mean by the determinant of a matrix is an oriented volume of a parallelepiped whose edge are its columns? It's very easy to see with the determinant of one time one matrices, so det A equals A, right? This is the oriented length, so the volume in that case is a length, we are in one dimension, of the parallelepiped. What is the parallelepiped in one dimension? This is the segment constructed on the horizontal line between zero and the point M of coordinate A. So the determinant is simply this, this A. It can be positive or negative. It's an algebraic quantity, it can be plus or minus, because M can be on the right of O or on the left. In that case, it will be positive or negative. Right? So the determinant of the one-by-one matrix is A, and A is the length of this segment, right? Very easy. So we can go to the determinant of two times two matrices. It's also easy to see what Arnold says. So what is the determinant of 2x2 matrix? It's AD minus BC. So what Arnold says, this is the oriented area because we are now in two dimensions, volume in two dimensions is a surface, of a parallelepiped, which is basically here, the lozenge constructed in the plane, we are in the plane now, it's a 2x2 matrix, with the points M of coordinate AB, and n of coordinate CD. So AD minus BC is this surface here contained in this yellow geometric figure, right? And again, it can be positive or negative. It's an algebraic quantity because M can be on the right side of n or on the left side of n, right? Okay, good. So now I'm going to conclude. To conclude, let me quote Arnold again. What is a group? Arnold says. Algebraists teach that this is supposedly a set with two operations that satisfy a load of easily forgettable axioms. This definition provokes a natural protest. Why should any sensible person need such pair of operations? Oh, curse this maths, concludes the students, who will possibly become the minister of science in the future. So Arnold is very concerned by what people understand of mathematics and what they will conclude later on in their life, in particular if they become minister of science. We get a totally different situation if we start off not with the group, but with a concept of a transformation, a one-to-one mapping of a set onto itself, as it was done historically. A collection of transformation of a set is called a group if, along with two any transformation, it contains the result of a consecutive application and an inverse transformation along with every transformation. This is all the definition there is. The so-called axioms are in fact just obvious properties of group of transformation. What axiomatizators, you saw how Arnold is considering these people. So here is really, I'm going to say something after that. Okay. So what axiomatizators call abstract groups are just groups of transformation of various sets concerned up to isomorphisms, which are one-to-one mappings preserving the operation. As Cayley proved, there are no more abstract groups in the world. So why do algebraists keep on tormenting students with the abstract definition? Okay. So this is Arnold. So in the 90s, one day I was at Institut Poincaré, and there was a discussion between Arnold and a very famous French mathematician who was the founder of Bourbaki. Have you heard of Bourbaki? Somebody knows Bourbaki? You, yes, of course, but the young people. Do you know Bourbaki? So Bourbaki was a group of French mathematicians which started working together, I think, in the 50s or the 40s in France, and tried to reformulate and reconstruct all mathematics in a totally systematic, abstract, logical, axiomatist point of view. Right? And one of the best, one of the leading figure in this movement, Bourbaki, was Serre, a very well-known French mathematician. So I was in the 90s at a discussion at Institut Henri Poincaré, and there was Serre and Arnold. And in the audience, in the room as today, it was full of French mathematicians, either active mathematicians or people, teachers in high school or superior schools, or retired mathematicians. So all the audience was totally for Serre, right, and Bourbaki. And Arnold was there, and he was saying to Serre, I remember very well, this is completely crazy. And I remember Arnold going on the blackboard and saying, a segment is a segment. A segment, you draw 2 points, and you just draw the segment between these 2 points. A segment does not have to be defined as the maximum or the infimum of whatever, etc., as Bourbaki was doing. And it was very strange because in all the audience, all the people were totally shocked. You know, say, oh, what does he say? It's impossible to treat Serre in this way, etc. So Arnold was alone against everybody, but he was a very courageous guy. And he was saying simply obvious thing, that a segment is a segment. It's very simple. You draw it on a piece of paper, right? Okay, a bit in advance, but if you have questions, I'm done. So are you happy with my negative numbers? No.